costume change.
Hi, everybody. I'm Jim.
I'm Ryan.
And this is the Concept Crucible Podcast.
And today we talk about character.
Yeah, specifically your own. Our own. Which is the only character to which we can really speak.
Hmm. I feel like this is a spiritual... the spiritual offspring of our virtue ethics throwdown a little bit. Because when we did the pre-show for this...
There was a bit of a throwdown.
Yeah, we ended up coming back to the language of virtue.
Mm-hmm.
Because surprisingly, or perhaps unsurprisingly, when you and I started pre-showing this, it turned out to be a lot more complicated and more difficult to discuss and nail down than perhaps initially I had thought.
Yeah, it's stupid. What's the thing that John Green always says? Stupid truth always resisting simplicity.
Yeah. No, it's one of those things, I guess, what did I expect if you get two ex-philosophy students in a room talking about something that's kind of nebulous at best, and then boom. Yeah.
I don't know. I like character because it is a useful way of talking about some things. When we talk about people of good character, we are capable of having specific ideas about what that means.
Mm-hmm.
Even if those ideas don't line up one-to-one, it gives us a way to talk about it.
Mm-hmm.
So it's one of those, I think, like useful cognitive or linguistic shortcuts.
Mm-hmm.
So our icebreaker is, how do you, like you and me, how do we improve our character? Like, assuming that we are not people of good character, or that we could be people of better character, which I definitely could be, what do you do that? How do you develop it?
I took a fairly virtue ethics point of view.
So shocked.
So shocked. So surprising. And I started to read books about people who had traits that I wanted to emulate. And I suppose I break away with traditional virtue ethics because I don't think of like one person having to embody everything.
Mm-hmm.
I guess I'm sufficiently jaded enough to know that I'm going to have to piecemeal things together in order to
make yourself into some kind of Franken-Voltron.
Yeah, pretty much. You know, it's like arms and legs and chest piece and something that comes out and just goes, you know.
Who forms the head, Ryan?
I don't know. For this one, I was thinking Megazord.
Fair.
But so I started reading books, and it's kind of hard because it's been a long kind of process of the books that I've been choosing are just like really long. For example, one of the ones that I started with was the Theodore Roosevelt trilogy, and I read the three books over the course of 3 years because each book clocks in at like 800 pages.
Mm-hmm.
Which realistically I could read all of those in a year based on last year's reading habits, but nevertheless, like, it was just, I bought on my birthday every year another one of the books, and I would read through it over the course of the year.
Okay.
And so I tried to pick out the things that I liked about them and try to, you know, what is it about it that I like, and, you know, recognize the things that I didn't like about them and kind of distance myself from them. You know, like, I mean, this is kind of a trivial example, but in the case of Theodore Roosevelt, you know, like, he liked to hunt, and he had a little bit of that bloodlust in him, so I'm not really big on that, but he also seemed to at times exhibit empathy towards nature, that, you know, he did set up national parks and whatnot, even if it was also for hunting purposes, but, you know, he thought it was important to treat the animals with respect, even if you are hunting them. Like, he didn't, like, wantonly killing things.
That's some virtue ethics with rose-colored glasses.
Oh, totally, totally. You have to really... There's a lot of, like, cognitive manipulation in order to get into it. I mean, I'm just not a hunter, period. Like, I don't hunt. I fish on occasion, but even then, I haven't done that in years. So, yeah, that's the way that I primarily go about it, is picking people that I want to learn more about, and learn more about them, and reading books about them.
Hmm. You can find those people now. They're alive. They have Twitter.
Yep. I don't know. I guess you're right about that. I guess I like people whose stories are already done, that you could get the entire thing, you know. Like, for example, I really want to find a good biography, a good authorized biography of like, for example, Barack Obama. But the problem is anything that's written is going to necessarily stop at the end of his presidency, and now it's going to be really interesting to see from the presidency until the end of his life what happens next.
You're going to be waiting for that thing for a while, man.
No, I'm totally going to be waiting for a while. It's just, the other thing is, I'm so tired of being disappointed by people who take wrong turns. Right. You're like, you really like them, then all of a sudden it's like, no, why did you do that? You totally just, like, did something criminal.
That's a topic for another podcast.
Yeah, I know.
So for me, it's interesting that yours is entirely, like, research-based.
Yeah.
You know, you when you're like, how do I become... you know, a better person. I mean, not, and that's actually probably a too broad a question for today. You know, people of good character are good people, but there's more nuance available than that. Hmm. But how do I become steadier, wiser? Hmm. Like, not simply a better person morally, but better at being a person.
Yeah. Well, there's two immediate criticisms to what I'm doing.
They're all written by 6 foot tall white men.
Okay, three criticisms. The other two is, for example, people who write leadership books are often people who didn't learn leadership from books.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so, and this kind of dovetails with the second criticism, some that Marcus Aurelius said of, and of course, always going back to history, but stop arguing about what it means to be a good person. I'm paraphrasing here. Just be a good person.
Mm. So, in the vein of both of those, I also have a copy of Marcus Aurelius' Meditations.
Yeah.
I sort of try and improve my character by taking on responsibilities that scare me. You know, whether that's serving on boards, you know, being people's friends in times of need, you know, doing new stuff at work. Whether that's like I want, you know, for me it's about finding out who I am. And the only way to really find you know, the only way to find out if you have strength is if you test it.
Mm-hmm.
It is easy to claim to be a strong person when you have never had to, you know, struggle. And so when I have like an opportunity to do something and it frightens me in a particular kind of way, like usually it's a friend of mine would describe it as delicious scary. Like it's both tantalizing and frightening.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and I have to ask questions like why am I scared of this? Like and often it's I am scared that this is a responsibility that I will not live up to. And you know, then I have conversations with the people who are you know involved in helping me gain or give that opportunity or giving me that opportunity.
Mm-hmm.
About that, and then I do it. More often than not, I will, and this results to saying yes to too many things sometimes.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it results in ambitious, sometimes ambitious goals that I fall short of, and I do whole bunches of time, or I wind up, you know, pulling all-nighters, getting up at 4 a.m. to do stuff. It's, you know, it is perhaps not the optimal way, but it's the only way I know how. And it is the idea that I can't learn it from a book. I have to, because even if I learn it, knowing things won't tell me the kind of person that I am.
Mm-hmm.
What I do and how I feel about what I do, you know, is what I am. So, and I think that's where we get into the distinction between character and like ethics.
Mm-hmm.
Is character is in some ways I think both more and less than ethic than just, you know, ethics and requires I think less cashing out.
Mm-hmm.
Because we've got all these cognitive shortcuts.
Mm-hmm.
To what that means.
Mm-hmm.
But I mean, the larger question, I guess, is what is character? Like, I think that our strategies here are describing different views of character.
Mm-hmm.
So when you say a person has good character, when you say that you want to be a person of good character, What do you mean when you say that?
Whenever I think about character, I can never separate it out from, I think, the first instance of character, building character, that I was ever exposed to, which was Calvin and Hobbes. Whenever Calvin had to do chores, and he would always question his father in terms of, why should I be doing this? You know, like, the father wants to mow the grass, so he needs the sticks picked up in the air, and he tasks Calvin to do this, and Calvin's like, why do you do it? And his answer was always, it builds character. And then the final panel of Calvin grumbling while picking up sticks or something like that. Like, funny how every time I build character, Dad saves $200 on a snowblower. You know, those kind of gripes about it. So that's usually when I think about character, there's some sort of genesis in that kind of first exposure to it. But beyond that, I find it's a little bit harder to kind of think clearly about it in my case, because it tends to bring up a bunch of different things, you know, like building character, in some sense as having a reputation, as knowing what to do, as being reliable. But these are kind of qualities that aren't necessarily about what having good character is,
mm-hmm.
or even if it's meaningful to talk about having good character, you know?
I think that it is meaningful, at least insofar as we can communicate about it. Like, I think that it's necessarily a little oblique,
mm-hmm.
a little obscured, opaque is the word I was looking for, not oblique, although I guess that would also work. That's obtuse.
Yeah. I am being obtuse right now.
That's correct.
As opposed to being acute.
Yeah, it seems useful to talk about it, at least insofar as when you recommend someone and you say that they have good, they're, you know, they're a person of good character. That communicates certain things.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, and it communicates things based as much on what that person you're talking to thinks of you,
mm-hmm.
as it does of the person that you're referring to,
mm-hmm.
outside of that conversation. You know, like, are you a good judge of character?
Mm-hmm.
You know, are you, like, there's this notion of interconnectedness. I like to think about character as, and I did a video about this, and I talked about kids as future people. I mean, kids are people already, but there is a point in life, in other people's lives, when you look at them and you're like, you are no longer becoming a person. You're no longer at a stage where you're sort of always learning about everything. You know, and we mark this with usually with adulthood. Like there is a mode of adulthood where there are certain things you were expected to know.
Mm-hmm.
If you did not learn those things, it is on you to learn them.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there's a point where other adults around you stop being your teachers.
Mm-hmm.
And like one of our responsibilities being around kids is to essentially act as their teachers or act as their models. Like even if they are not your kids, modeling things like patience and, you know, other good traits teaches kids about the world.
Mm-hmm.
It teaches kids about the kinds of people in that exist in the world, the kinds of people they can trust, the kinds of people they can rely on. Like they learn all kinds of things. They're going to learn from you whether you want it or not. So teaching them becomes important. But there's a point where we that changes, and we're like, you're just the person I'm going to have to deal with for whatever amount of time.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you're not being informed by me unless you explicitly want to be.
Mm-hmm.
You are who you are, and that is a thing that we can sort of think about other people, but about ourselves, of course, we realize that we're always works in progress.
Mm-hmm.
We're always in the process of becoming.
Mm-hmm.
And the advantage of being an adult is not that it slows down, but that we can think more clearly about it. That we are capable of understanding more about our choices and about our responsibilities with regard to those choices. Mm-hmm.
Or at the very least, you're expected to have the requisite amount of experience to allow you to think about it.
Sure. And in that sense, my brain just completely stopped, but that's okay.
Okay, I'm sorry, did I derail your
No. But it's the idea that when I talk about character and when I think about character, what I am thinking about is the kind of person that I want to be.
Mm-hmm.
And that isn't just the kind of person that I am, it's the kind of person that I'm going to be in the next 5 minutes, shaped by the decisions that I make, by the words that I say, by the actions that I take,
mm-hmm.
or don't take, or don't say.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, like, becoming isn't a thing that just happens, you know, in a year or over years. It happens in every single moment. I mean, that you know, to get Aristotelian about it, virtue isn't something you can do once in a while. You have to do it all the time.
Yeah.
If you stop doing it, not only are you not virtuous, you never were.
Yeah. Yeah. It's a really weird concept to wrap your mind around the first time you kind of encounter it, but once you understand it, makes sense.
Yeah. Is a person is not a person of good character until they turn on you. It is the fact that they would never turn on you
mm-hmm.
that makes them that way.
Mm-hmm.
And for me, that always centers around trust.
Mm-hmm.
Like trust is the basis of... I'm going to go with trust is the basis of almost all human relationships.
Mm-hmm.
At least in some sense. Like, mm-hmm. having a relationship with anyone means being vulnerable. Vulnerability requires trust.
Yep.
I mean, it also can require necessity.
Mm-hmm.
And that's a whole other conversation for a whole other podcast.
Mm-hmm.
But, and being trustworthy means acknowledging responsibility. Like, it means taking action related to that. And all of those things are things that are outside of being trustworthy.
Mm-hmm.
And I think they make up the pieces of having good character.
I can't help but to think of character and trust and whatnot as our solution to maybe not ambiguity, but just not knowing the future.
Mm.
Like and the only reason why I bring this up, and the reason why I started thinking about this, is because last night, instead of going to bed at an appropriate time, I started watching Star Trek Deep Space Nine, and there's this really interesting exchange that makes up the entire, like, the bulk of the first episode, where Benjamin Sisko encounters a species of alien who have non-corporeal existence and seemingly atemporal existence,
mm-hmm.
or non-temporal, perhaps, is a better way to describe it. And so he's trying to communicate with them without having a real common frame of reference, and they keep remarking that, you know, he's a corporeal being, it's so weird, and he keeps describing living as linear. And they apparently experience time non-linearly.
Sure.
And so he keeps trying to describe to them in a way that makes sense that humans live in a certain fixed point, not maybe fixed, but they live in a precise moment of time and space. Everything before that moment is the past. Everything in front of it is the future. Anything that has already happened can't go back and you know, fix. And anything that's to come before you hasn't happened yet. And they tend to remark, like, well, what, you prize your ignorance? He says that's the whole, for example, he uses baseball as a metaphor in the explanation.
Of course he does.
Well, of course he does, yeah. But he says knowing the outcome would necessarily preclude wanting to play the game for humans. The fact that we don't know how it's going to end makes the game more valuable to us. And he uses that as a springboard that humans, because they don't know what's going to happen next, are in some sense always exploring. They're always naturally curious about the world, even if you don't think about it in those terms. But the fact that we don't have a firm knowledge of what's going to happen next means that we end up having to trust, and we have to constantly be learning and evaluating based on new information.
It's really interesting to me that your example is outwardly focused. Is that idea of like, we are constantly, and I used the idea of constantly becoming and that means like exploring outward, like into our future selves. We are staring at an array of shoes that in the next moment we will step into, and all of them fit, some better than others. I tend to actually think of it about it in the other way, in a more inward focused way, which is I spend like a middling amount of effort most of the time on being myself. And I've had to spend a lot of time thinking about what that means. I am still in the process of thinking about that, but it is a middling amount of effort.
Can I just poke at that for a second? Being yourself or acting as yourself?
So, yes.
Okay.
I'll expand on that. One of the sort of wonderful symptoms of my anxiety is I have a lot of ideas all the time. And this is really cool most of the time. I refer to it as a brain problem because I make up song lyrics and ideas for stuff and whatnot. But I have a lot of other ideas, too, that are distinctly less useful. Especially when I was a kid, I had a lot of behavior problems because I had trouble distinguishing between which of these were good ideas and which of them weren't. Most famously, I think I wrote a blog post about it. When I was in kindergarten, I met a kid. He was bent over. He was looking at something on the ground. And my brain was like, he's in the perfect position for you to just, like, punch him in the face. Like if you just, like, brought your fist up into his face, like, that would be the perfect motion. And I did. For record, he kicked my ass. For double record, we were best friends for the next, like, 15 years, and we actually just reconnected, like, 6 months ago. And he's a super cool dude.
It's funny how things work out that way.
I wasn't mad at him. I didn't hate him. It was just, like, my brain was like, this is a really good idea. And the rest of my brain was like, we have trouble making decisions. Mm-hmm. So there's a sense in which, like, I need to maintain focus on deciding the kind of person I want to be. What the kind of person I want to be is not the kind of person who does that, you know, is the kind of person who is kind and tells the truth and pays attention and listens and, you know, is gentle and all kinds of other things. And I have set up, like, regardless of the kind of person that I am, which is a much larger and harder question, performatively, I think you're right that a lot of it is performative. You know, it's that question of, is character something you are, or is character something you do? And I think when we came out in the pre-show too that who you are is read by everyone else as the things that you do.
Yeah, most of the time when you talk about character, it tends to get cashed out in who you are. But
people, we want to be essentialists about it.
Yeah, we want it to be fixed, we want it to be understandable, we want it to be knowable, and that once it's established, it doesn't change.
I actually want to throw out, there was a Kamala Khan fan movie that came out recently. Just like a short little 5-minute piece. It's super good. She's the new Ms. Marvel.
Okay.
And not even new at this point. And she's amazing. But there's a line in the one of the early issues where she's a teenager with superpowers and she spends a lot of time worrying about whether she's a good person or not and what it means. And you know, it's the beyond the Spider-Man power and responsibility thing, like you know, when she keeps secrets, when she puts her life at risk, when she sometimes puts other people's lives at risk, you know, if she fails to act, like her question is constantly sort of, am I a good person? And at one point she has this light bulb moment, and she says, good isn't something you are, good is something you do. And that, I mean, then it's superhero time.
Yeah.
But, and it's that idea of if you are a good person but do no good, then, I mean, all that is required for evil to triumph is for good people to do nothing. to get into additional aphorisms and platitudes.
Yeah.
So I think that that largely character is something you do. I think we like to think about it as essential to people. We like to think that we, you know, in the same way that we like to think that we are good with people.
Mm.
We're people. You know, it's easier to think about that way. It's certainly easier to think about that way with reference to ourselves.
Mm-hmm.
But, I mean, ultimately, I'm going to go with ultimately character and necessarily is performative.
Mm-hmm.
Because without doing good, and whether that means, looking out for people and putting their interests ahead of yours, being trustworthy and being responsible, honoring your responsibilities, you lack the character to do so. You lack the courage of your convictions.
Mm-hmm.
And we have established previously in a podcast that courage is in fact a virtue.
Yeah.
You know, Aristotle would, we should really link to the throwdown. Aristotle would tell us that if you have courage and you do not act, then you did not have courage at all.
Yeah. So link in the show notes.
So we've talked a bunch about building character in ourselves, which is easy to talk about. We are ourselves. We are the people who know the most about ourselves and about what we mean when we talk about things. What about building character in other people?
So this is not something we talked about in the pre-show, but it's something that came up when you were describing wrestling with the concept of who do I want to be?
Mm.
And I wanted to pose a question at the time, and now I have the opportunity to do it, because this is in some way how, when I reflect back on me as a child, I think I did something like this, and I think with my children, I might do something like this as well. So my question to you was, when you were growing up, did you take on one or more models that you wanted to be when you grew up?
No.
No? Not at all?
No. So I would have moments where people would do things. Like the obvious answer is like Superman or Wonder Woman or characters like that. But, you know, and you have those moments where like characters or people really sort of touch you. But the answer is no. Like not until I was much older. Like until I was definitively not a child.
Yeah.
And I was like, this is a useful thing to do and to understand.
Because I did it a little bit. Now, it wasn't consistent all the time, but I think I've talked about it on the podcast before. When I was a child, I wanted to grow up and be a Power Ranger.
Shocked,
obviously. and as an adult, when I reflect back on it, I'm like, you know what? There are certainly worse
examples. Oh, yeah, totally. Examples. No, the Power Rangers, you're doing all right.
Yeah, I mean, like, parents always miss the fact. Like, so, obviously, yes, yeah, colorful spandex, fighting, and stuff like that. I can understand a parent's initial worry, not knowing anything else about Power Rangers, of why they might be worried about it. But I always go back and I reflect that Zordon, in the, you know, the first episode, lays out the laws that
help teenagers with attitude.
No. Lays out the three laws that they must abide. Now, they could have developed it more, but it was a kid's show, and they needed a way to explain why that they're always like
have secret identities. I don't know what these are, so I'm going to tell me.
I'm explaining it. So, there are three laws. Is basically never use the powers to gain, like to profit or gain.
Mm.
Never use the powers to escalate a fight unless it's already been escalated. And never,
that's really clever.
And never tell anybody your secret. So obviously these were rules that they needed to explain why they had out of suit fighting, in suit fighting, and Megazord fighting. And they were interesting contrived rules to help explain, or at least to help give credibility to the world that they lived in.
But it's interesting, like thinking about it narratively, to break from this for a moment.
Yeah.
Is that why don't we get in the Megazord and smash monsters? Because when a monster gets big and it starts smashing the city, you have no choice but to respond with the Megazord.
Yeah.
When you climb into your giant robot and smash a building while trying to crush a small monster, that's you. You did that.
Yeah.
You escalated that to the point where that damage was inevitable.
Yeah.
I did not know that, and I really find that interesting.
As an adult, when I went back and reflected on it, it was amazing, and I realized that I would be perfectly comfortable sitting my kids down in front of Power Rangers and having, at the very least,
dude who, like, professionally de-escalates people in situations.
Yeah.
So, I'm shocked.
Yeah, and in some sense, I think there's been a lurking podcast that eventually we'll do in terms of, like, where we got our moral compass from.
Oh, yeah, totally.
And then this is going to be one thing I was going to talk about. But as a precursor, if I wanted to build certain virtues in my children, or, you know, give a good model, if I were to pick the model side of things... one way of building character in children would be to set them up with the appropriate models, which, you know what? Plato said the same thing in the Republic, and I have a conflict in me about censorship and whatnot of the poets and whatnot, that there's only one kind of moral education, and it's the right kind, and everything else needs to be
excluded. Yeah, I mean, your kids would probably learn a lot from Marilyn Manson.
Probably, yeah. So, like, I know it's really, you know, it's fraught with some problems, and I haven't thought it through all that well, but because you had talked about wrestling, essentially, like, wrestling with your Freudian id. Wrestling with the Freudian id, that you needed a way of stopping impulses, and in some sense you had to start to build the person that you wanted to be. And then I wanted to ask about this. Mm-hmm. This could be one way of approaching it in terms of having these kind of moral exemplars to model character. I mean, yeah.
It also means that I mean, implicitly we have just talked about the fact that we think it is appropriate to attempt to build character in children.
Yeah.
I mean, and I talked about that with Future People, too. Like, the Future People video is strictly about my nieces, but, I mean, it is true for other kids that I am around, which is, you know, like, they are going to learn from me. The least I can do as an adult is try and be the kind of person worth learning from.
Yeah.
And I think everyone can imagine that time when they learned something as a kid that they wish they had not been taught. Mm. But, and I think there's lots of other, I think, situations where we build character in others. And it's, you know, teachers, for example.
Mm-hmm.
You're necessarily... teaching your students a certain element of character. You're trying to, you know, even insofar as you, like, being good students, alone being good citizens, for example, if you're a high school teacher or a junior high teacher, or, you know, where there's a lot more teaching involved because you're teaching actual, like, you're still teaching children.
Mm-hmm.
As opposed to university professors, where the people you are teaching are adults, they have explicitly consented to take your lessons.
Mm-hmm.
Because I mean, with adults, like, consent in character building seems deeply essential. I mean, drill sergeants, for example. Drill sergeants are trying to build into you a certain kind of character. They want you to be the kind of person who can do a job under stress.
Mm-hmm.
And that means, like, being both, like, physically and mentally fit to do that job.
Mm-hmm.
Whether that's fix engines or, you know, defuse mines.
Mm-hmm.
And, like the kinds of things that we do to try and build character in others, I mean, use the Calvin's dad example, you know, or teachers assigning pop quizzes, or drill sergeants making you do push-ups. There's, like, must be done with their consent.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it is sort of necessarily the case. I mean, trying to build character in somebody else without their consent means that we have taken on the role of master or teacher or, you know, giver of guidance, minister, priest, without them letting us do that, without them giving us that option, that choice.
Mm-hmm.
And we've taken that choice away from them. Is a thing that I don't know. I find it gets really interesting. I have definitely done this in discussions You know, and I think that if you've had the sort of philosophy discussion, you've had that thing happen where you're like, okay, like, we're going to have this discussion, and I'm strictly going to have this discussion to sort of try and teach you something.
Mm-hmm.
I've definitely had those discussions with regard to things like social justice issues and whatnot, where it's like the only purpose of having this discussion is that hopefully, God, you'll fucking learn something.
Mm-hmm. How very Socratic of you.
Yeah. But Socrates is an asshole.
Yep.
And we recognize it's like Socrates, while the dialogues are entertaining,
yeah,
he's being a giant dick.
Yeah.
He's like, I presume that you will teach me about these things or that I will teach you about them and you will learn about them, because I will talk at you incessantly until you've reached some sort of imaginary state.
Mm-hmm.
That I have imagined for you and that you haven't consented to.
Mm-hmm.
Which is why, if you read the Euthyphro or the Meno or any of those, like, half of that dialogue is the other person going, please go away. Why are you still here? Please fuck off.
It is not entirely surprising that the city-state put Socrates to death.
Anyway, I don't know. I dig the Euthyphro.
Yeah.
There's some good stuff in there. Oh, yeah. But there's other ways to accomplish that.
Mm-hmm.
Oh. Character. If you're a person of good character, leave a comment. If you are not, also leave a comment.
Yeah, I mean, please, let me know if you're a good person of character. I want to learn from you, because apparently that's how I roll.
He's going to read your book.
I'll read your book.
Unless you're not dead, in which case, no chance.
Yeah, it's usually an unauthorized one. Yeah. Yeah. You need a couple of sources to corroborate information. It's just really messy when they're still alive.
Send hug your resume. It's fine. It's fine. Oh, man.
Your moral CV.
That'd be the most awful thing ever.
I wonder what that would look like.
It would be terrible. It would be the humble braggiest of humble brag things.
Yeah, you're right.
And with that...
Yes.
I'm Jim.
I'm Ryan.
And we're signing off.
Stay awesome.
Stay awesome.
Doth Plagueis the Wise. It's kind of hard to tell because there's the record button.
That microphone's totally in shot.
Ah.